The unit that we are going to start now is a very scoring and easy unit. Although the number of questions asked from this unit in GATE is very limited and also not very difficult. So this thing makes this unit very easy and very scoring. Okay. The name of this unit is availability or available energy or exergy. The concept that we are going to learn is availability or available energy or exergy. In some of the sources or books, you will find that they are defined differently. They have mentioned that exergy is different, available energy is different, availability is different, but that's not the case. GATE has considered all of them to be same. There has been questions in GATE where availability was asked, then available energy was asked, but same thing was calculated for different scenarios as well. Okay, so treat them to be same for GATE. And you will realize very soon that why the name of our institute, Exergic, was named after exergy. Okay, you will realize that what is the importance of available energy. So let's start this unit. But before that, let's understand that what exactly we are going to study here. Look, in the first law, we understood that both heat and work are path functions, right? Both of them are same type of energies in that sense that both of them are path function. Both of them depend upon the process, how we carried out the process, correct? But in second law, we realize that both of them are not equivalent, right? We can completely convert work to heat, but we cannot completely convert heat to work. So they are not equivalent, although they are same type. And why we were not able to do that? Why we were not able to completely convert both of them into the other type? Because work is a high grade energy, right? It is more ordered form of energy, more oriented form of energy. So high grade energy can be completely converted into a low grade energy. Work was high grade energy. Heat, low grade energy. Hence work can be completely converted to heat. But if we have some low grade energy and we want to convert it into a high grade energy, like we have some heat and we want to extract the work from it, we cannot extract equivalent amount of work because low grade energy has some part of it. From this whole block, I am just showing a certain portion of it to be available as high grade energy. The rest part of it, this is not available to be converted and cannot be converted to high grade energy. So this again is left as low grade, right? We cannot completely convert heat into work. Some part of it only can get converted to work. Other part will have to be rejected as low grade energy. And we saw this in heat engines, right? We were having heat engines. Heat was supplied. Equivalent amount of work could not be produced. We have to reject some of the heat for it, correct? So let's go back to that concept. Suppose we have a reservoir which is supplying some heat Q. Okay, let's say Q1. And we want to know that how much work we can extract from this heat. So how can you do that? How much work does this low grade energy contain? How can you do that? By using an heat engine, correct? And you have to define that to what temperature that heat was going. So we installed a heat engine. This heat engine will produce some work and reject some heat because low grade energy cannot be completely converted to high grade energy. So this, let's say, is Q1, total content. This is W and this is Q2, the heat being rejected. Okay. This heat engine is producing work W. Now, if I ask you that what is the availability of this heat Q1, then the maximum amount of work that you can extract from heat is the availability of that heat. It means that into this diagram, this is the availability of this much heat. Of this much heat, this much is available as high grade work. Similarly, in this case, if I want to tell you that if Q1 is the heat being supplied by T1 and going to temperature T2, thermal reservoir T2, then how much work can I extract from this Q1 is the availability or available energy or exergy. Okay, I'm repeating this, that availability is the maximum amount of high grade energy that you can extract from a low grade energy. In terms of heat and work, the maximum amount of work that you can extract from a certain quantity of heat is the availability of that heat. Suppose this is 15 kilojoule and the amount of work that you can do is 10 kilojoule. 5 has to be rejected. So this heat Q1 of 15 kilojoule has exergy, has availability, has available energy of 10 kilojoule. It is understood that we are talking about work only. You do not have to mention work again and again. You just have to mention that availability of this heat is this much. Availability inherently means that maximum work. Okay. Now, there are some cautions that you need to take in this. If you use any heat engine, any type of heat engine, then can you say that whatever work it is producing is the availability? No. We are talking about maximum high grade energy content, maximum work that you can extract from it. When you can extract maximum work, can any heat engine, reversible or irreversible, will give same amount of work? If you install a irreversible heat engine in the same temperature difference, from the Carnot principle, we know that its efficiency will be less. Hence, for the same amount of heat, it will produce less work. So, maximum extraction, maximum juice that you can extract from this heat will be when the heat engine is going to be a reversible heat engine. So, in case of heat engine, you can say that W reversible is equal to W max is equal to available energy. So, this is one thing that you should keep in mind. Another caution that you need to take is, and this one is especially for the beginners, that suppose we have a system like this one only, that we have a reservoir T1 through which heat is being supplied to another reservoir T2. Okay, heat is transferred. Now, if I ask you that what is the availability of this heat? So, some of the beginners may say that availability is zero. Why? Because there is no heat engine and we are not extracting any work. So, availability is zero. No, it's not like that. I am showing heat engine here does not mean that there is actually we are using a heat engine. Availability is maximum amount of work that you can extract. Does not mean that you are extracting, that you can extract. What is the possibility of extracting maximum work? What is that amount that you can possibly extract from this heat? That is equal to availability. There should not be an actual heat engine used in that case. Okay. So, for this heat which is coming from T1 and going to T2, how much is the availability? To know that, we are using a heat engine. We are installing a heat engine here. Though, in reality, we do not have to actually install a heat engine, but theoretically, we can install a heat engine and we can say that heat Q is coming. What is the maximum work that it can produce if we use a reversible heat engine? And less rest heat will be Q minus W max will be rejected. So this is the availability of the heat that we are talking about, right? Now let's look mathematically into W max. So when a heat is moving from a particular temperature to another temperature, we have taken both of them to be a reservoir, then how much maximum work we can produce is the availability of that. Hence, availability is equal to W max, which is equal to reversible work when produced, when we use a heat engine to produce work. And what is that equal to? Heat input multiplied by thermal efficiency, right? Efficiency is equal to heat, is equal to work output divided by heat input. Work output is this, heat input is this. So this is the relation that we will be having. Q input is Q1 here. And what is the thermal efficiency of a reversible heat engine? And mind you, again, this is not any thermal efficiency. It is the maximum thermal efficiency, which you can also write it as reversible efficiency. So how much is that equal to? 1 minus T2 by T1. You cannot randomly write Q2 by Q1. That will refer to a general case. Maximum efficiency is when Q2 by Q1 is equal to T2 by T1 for reversible heat engine. So this is the availability, you can say, of available energy of any heat which is moving from a temperature T1 to another temperature T2, right? I'm repeating it that it is not necessary that there should be a heat engine. There can be just a heat transfer from T1 to T2. And if you are asked that how much is the availability of that heat, means how much maximum work you can extract from that heat. Okay, and that will be equal to an imaginary heat engine, imaginary reversible heat engine being used there to extract heat from that, to extract work from that. Okay, now from this relation, you can clearly see that higher will be the value of T1, lower will be this ratio. If this ratio is lower, since here is a subtraction sign, so if this ratio is lower, this whole term will be higher. And if this whole term is higher, available energy will be higher. Hence, higher the value of T1, more will be the available energy. So it means that higher is going to be the value of temperature, more will be the work that we can extract from it. Just forget about the concepts. Just consider it to be a simple heat engine. It is very obvious that more will be this temperature because T2 is not changing. Right now, I am not changing T2 nor Q1. I am just changing T1, correct? And if same amount of heat, let's say 15 kilojoule, is being coming from a 300 Kelvin source, then you will put 300 air. And if it is coming from 800 Kelvin source, then you will put 800 air. Both the values of available energy or both the values of work that you can extract will be different. And higher the value of T1, more will be the work that you can extract from a heat engine. It means that higher will be the temperature from which we are extracting heat, more will be the ability of heat to do work. The availability of a work, of a heat, does not only depend upon how much heat that is. That depends upon heat. More will be the heat you extract, more work you can produce. Obvious. But it also depends upon the temperature from which we are extracting heat. Higher will be that temperature, more will be the availability of that heat. Now, let me give you a practical life example to justify this. You would have listened or read different theories that from the friction we are going to generate work, because friction ultimately causes heat, right? So the friction between car tires and road, our soul and the road, the braking of cars, the braking of bikes due to which heat is produced, from that we are going to extract work. You would have listened to such theories, and there are, they have made some of the devices as well, but those are not very effective and you do not see any, you know, prevalent use of those. Why? What is the reason for that? The reason is that although they are producing some heat, but that heat is not coming from a very high temperature. In power plants, the temperature that we reach, the maximum temperature that we reach, is very high. We extract heat from that particular temperature, right? We heat them up using boilers. In combustion engines, the energy is produced due to heating. The high temperatures are reached due to combustion. From that temperature, we are extracting the work. Or you can say the heat which is ultimately getting converted into work. So the amount of heat that we are extracting is not enough. The temperature from we are extracting that heat also matters. Hence, all these concepts of extracting heat from friction and then using it for work are not very justifiable and are not very practical in real life when it comes to application or implementation. And there is a famous statement for this also, that we do not have energy crisis in the world. There's a lot of energy which is being wasted, for example, in friction. So you cannot say that there is not enough energy in this world. We have energy. Energy is not going anywhere, right? It cannot be destroyed. It is still there. But we have exergy crisis. Energy crisis is nothing. We have exergy crisis. Though this term is technical, hence we do not use it. You will read energy crisis term only, that there is energy crisis. We need to import energy from other countries. We need more power plants to make more energy. But actually, you cannot make energy, right? You can only extract exergy from the available heat energy. Hence, we have exergy crisis in the world. There is not enough sources of heat available at a good temperature from which you can extract a good amount of work. I am not just talking about extracting work. It is possible to extract work. But what is the benefit of extracting work if the mechanism that you developed, machine you developed, maintenance that you have to do is costlier than the benefit that you will get from extracting the work, right? If you get so small work after, you know, coming up with the expensive device, expensive maintenance, what is the use of it? It is not going to be done, you know, on a large scale by industries, because it's not going to be profitable. Hence, we have exergy crisis in the world. The essence of energy, especially heat energy, is exergy only, right? So this is something which you should keep in mind. Also, if you keep T1 constant, you can see that T2 will now affect available energy. For the first example, we kept T2 constant. Now we are keeping T1 constant and varying T2. So if you decrease T2, this is T1, sorry, I missed writing T1 here. If you decrease T2, this will decrease, this will increase, this will increase. So AE will increase, available energy will increase. It means lower will be the bottom temperature, more energy you can extract from it. It naturally means that heat engines will be having more capacity to work on poles which are cooler. Hence, this temperature is basically the lowest temperature that is available to you. The main concept behind high temperature of T1 and low temperature of T2 is the range that you get. That is the main concept actually. That higher will be T1, lower will be the T2, more will be the range between those two temperatures. And that range is important, because ultimately what you have to do, you have to bring any particular body to the dead state. Dead state is that state when its state in terms of temperature especially is same as the ambient temperature. Suppose you have a hot potato. When it cools down and comes down to the room temperature, then you can say that it is at the dead state. Now, how much work you can extract from that hot potato? On what thing it depends? It depends upon two things. That what is the current temperature of it? How much heated up it is? And up to what extent it can be cooled? Because during that duration only, when there is delta T, then only heat is going to flow. Heat flow depends upon delta T. Q is equal to MC delta T. So delta T is the driving force for heat. More will be the delta T, more heat will flow, more work you can extract. Hence, the range of temperature available to any heat engine will define how much work we can extract in terms of availability. The range of temperature available in terms of what is the maximum temperature from you can extract heat and what is the minimum temperature to that you can reject heat. That will affect the availability of that heat. Hence, to define availability, you need three things. First, the quantity of heat itself. That we have 15 kilojoule of heat. This is required. Second, from what temperature this heat is coming. And third, from what temperature, to what temperature this heat is being rejected. These three things are required to define the availability. You cannot just say that a heat of 15 kilojoule will have that much of availability. That is incomplete statement. These are the three, you know, basic requirements needed to define the availability, the work potential, the available energy of any amount of heat. Okay. If I ask you that what is the availability of work, then what should be the answer? If we have a work of 20 kilojoule, how much is the availability of that work? The availability of work is equal to W itself. How much is the maximum work that you can extract from a work of 20 kilojoule? 20 kilojoule, common sense, right? It can be asked in different terms that you have a mass, you have a system and which is moving with a velocity, the mass is defined. We are also considering its potential energy, that it is at a certain height. So how much work that you can extract from that? Potential energy, the how much height it has from that atom, and the kinetic energy. So sum of them is going to be equal to the available energy for that system, correct? So for work, you just need to calculate what is the total magnitude of work, that itself is equal to available energy, because work itself is a high grade energy. Now in this case, we can clearly see that Q2 is the heat which is being rejected, or in terms of energy if you say, then Q2 is that energy which is not available for work, right? Hence Q2 is called as unavailable energy. Or it is sometimes also written as energy. In place of E, you write A, okay, which is showing that energy which is not available to you for work. Only this much part of Q1 is available for work. This is unavailable for work, correct? To find out the expression of Q2, which is unavailable energy, you can write this. What is W max? Q1, 1 minus T2 by T1. Q1, Q1 will get cancelled. You will get Q1 multiplied by T2 by T1. This is the expression unavailable energy of any heat Q1 which is being transferred from Q1 to Q2. Again, you can see that it is the function of Q1, T1 and T2. Correct? The same diagram that we have shown here, I am trying to show it in a different way like this. This is the temperature T1. A temperature below T1 is T2, and a temperature which is less than both of them is, let's say, T0. This T0 is the ambient temperature, the lowest temperature available to you. So you can say that earlier you were transferring the heat from some body at some particular temperature of a reservoir to another reservoir of other particular temperature. But we have a reservoir present which is less in temperature than both of them. And generally it is the air around us, that we are transferring heat from a hot source to a somewhat cold sink. But we have atmospheric air available, which is again a reservoir, right? Thermal energy reservoir, which is having a temperature less than both of them. So we have three reservoirs present. And what effectively is the process happening here? We are transferring heat from T1 to T2. Correct? Do not think that we have installed a heat engine. I am repeating it. It means that we are actually using a heat engine. This was just to show you that what exactly available energy is. That if we would have installed a heat engine, then what could have been the work output? That is equal to available energy. But ultimately, we are not using any heat engine. It is just a heat transfer from T1 to T2. Correct? So I have shown that here. Now, in every heat transfer from higher temperature to lower temperature, there will be loss of available energy. And that's what the name of topic is. Because when the heat Q was present here, which was coming out from T1, the potential of that heat to do work, the maximum potential of that heat to do work was between that and T0, right? But now when it has arrived at T2, what is the potential of this heat to do work between T2 and T0? Do not get confused that here I told you that maximum potential of heat to do work will be calculated by the temperature of T1 and T2. That was correct for that case, because question had mentioned only T1 and T2. I had mentioned only T1 and T2. I did not mention any temperature T naught other than T1 and T2. But suppose the question has given you a temperature which is less than T1 and T2. It has given you that there is a sink available which is having a lower temperature than T2. Then this is that sink T naught is going to define that how much maximum work you can extract. Keep in mind that maximum work extract that you can extract or availability depends upon the maximum temperature range which is available to you. If T1 and T2 is the maximum range available like it was earlier, then use T1 and T2. But suppose the question has given you T0 as I have shown here, then what is the maximum work that you can extract or what is the maximum available energy? That will depend upon the heat which is present. This is the heat Q present at T1 and the temperature range, maximum temperature range available, which is T1 and T0 here. Similarly, the heat which is at T2 now, how much is the maximum work that you can extract from that? Again, this temperature range is to be taken. T2 and the lowest temperature T0 available. What is the range available at that state? Correct? So here, for the case when Q was at T1, the maximum work that you can do was this much. Correct? This was the range available to you. After heat being transferred, this is the range available to you. So let's compare both of the work. Let's call it W1. Let's call it W2. So W1 is equal to Q multiplied by 1 minus T0 by T. Similarly, W2 is equal to Q multiplied by T1 divided by T2. Earlier, W1 was the ability to do work. Now W2 is the ability to do work or available energy. So how much is the loss in available energy due to this heat transfer? That is equal to W1 minus W2. Correct? So if you do that, if you subtract them, then Q and Q will get cancelled. And Q multiplied by, we will be having minus Q T0 by T1. And this will become minus minus plus Q T0 by T2. So we can take Q common and we will be having T, or we can also take, let's say, Q T0 common. And we will be having Q by T2 minus Q by T1. For this heat transfer, if I ask you that how much is the total change in entropy for this heat transfer, then you can clearly see that this is losing heat. So its entropy, change in entropy is minus Q by T1 and this is gaining heat. So its entropy increases Q by T2. So this is the total delta S for universe for this heat transfer. Correct? So, if you compare both of them, this is nothing but delta S of universe. This is loss of available energy. T0 multiplied by delta S of universe. You may be thinking, some of you may be thinking, because always there are some students who think which is not required. So, some of you may be thinking that T0 is also present in the universe. Why are we not taking T0 into consideration? Is there any heat transfer to T0? Actual heat transfer is between T1 and T2 only. We are showing this heat transfer just to know the value of maximum work that is available to us. Actual process is this one only. We have just introduced that, okay, now we also have a T0. But actual heat transfer is not occurring to T0. The system and surrounding for heat transfer is T1 and T2 only, right? Hence, in the universe, though there is T0 present, but there is not any heat being transferred or any interaction being done. So, delta S for T0, this reservoir, is effectively zero. Okay. So, this is the expression T0 delta S universe. It's a very important expression. The loss of available energy is going to be defined by this. And we tried to generalize this by writing delta S universe, because for every question, you are not going to have reservoirs, right? This is just a, you know, we are just starting up. We are just learning the different terminologies and the concepts. That is why we are simplified. We are going with the simplified approach by taking reservoirs. It's easy to define entropy, simply Q by T. But if we will be having some mass, like I'm giving you an example that we have a hot potato. I always give this example. We have a hot potato kept and at room temperature. And we want to know that how much is the loss of available energy. for the heat transfer that will be going on, because it's hot, so heat will be going out of it. How much is the available energy that we have lost? So for that, if you want to find out delta S of universe, you will have to find out delta S of potato plus delta S of surrounding, correct? For potato, you cannot write Q by T, you have to write MC ln T2 by T1, correct? Hence, I have used delta S universe, which is a more general approach towards loss of available energy. Now, let's continue this example of hot potato. So, we have the potato at temperature T, which is higher than the room temperature T0. It is cooling and coming down to temperature T0. During this, there is some heat which is getting transferred. I am asking you that what is the loss of available energy? Loss of available energy is equal to available energy that you have minus available energy that you extracted, right? How much available energy you cannot extract out of the present available energy, that is going to be a loss. How much available energy is present? Firstly, let's try to know that. To know that, we will assume hypothetically that there is some heat engine present between the potato and the room. There is no actual heat engine. And then we will calculate what is the work of that reversible heat engine. That is going to be the available energy present with us. Correct? How much available energy are we extracting in reality? Zero. There is just heat transfer. You are not using any heat engine between potato and the room. The heat is just getting lost. So the available energy present is same as available energy that is lost, because you are just giving it away like that. Correct? Hence, if this is the case, when we are transferring heat from T1 to T2, if I ask you that how much is the loss in available energy, again it is equal to how much energy, available energy, you could have extracted at T1 minus how much available energy you could have extracted at T2. The difference of them is the available energy that you could not extract, because at T2 you still have hope that you are going to extract something, because it's still higher than T0. Here there is no hope. Ultimately, potato has come down to room temperature. There is no delta T present. If T2 was equal to T0, then this heat engine will vanish. We will have same case that we have here. But here we have some temperature present at the final state, which is higher than the ambient temperature. So there is still some hope that we can extract some work from it. Hence, the loss in available energy for this case is equal to W1 minus W2. But for that case, if you compare this case with that case, here W max is same as W1, because that is directly rejecting heat to the lowest possible temperature. From this, we can also conclude that heat transfer is not good for available energy. Correct? Transferring a heat is actually reducing the available energy, and we already know that, because higher will be the temperature from which heat is coming, more will be the available energy. If you have reduced the available energy, if you have transferred the heat from higher temperature to lower temperature, you have reduced its ability to do work, because if you transferred heat from T1 and if you transferred heat from T2, both of them are going to be different, because the available energy in this heat is going to be different. Hence, heat transfer is decreasing the available energy present with us. Correct? Because it has now brought down heat to a lower temperature. Lower the temperature, lower will be the work potential. You can also say from this that heat transfer is irreversible. Because once you have transferred the heat from T1 to T2, you have lost the available work. The available work is lost. Loss means it is not going to come back. It is not change in available energy that we decrease it, then we increase it. It is lost. You cannot get it back. Now, if you try to get it back, how you can do that? You again have to bring this heat from T2 to T1. Then you will get that available energy back. But you cannot transfer heat in the opposite direction without doing some extra work. And extra work will ultimately require energy, so that it's of no point. Correct? Hence, from this also you can conclude that heat transfer is irreversible process. You cannot get back the energy. It is lost. You cannot revert the process back to gain heat, to gain work. It is lost. Correct?